Sonic X Episode 57. We start out with the heroes in their spaceship instead of on the planet of last time. So what's stopping the Metrix from immediately returning to the desert planet and destroying it anyways? Logically, all their victories should be meaningless because Tails didn't make an anti-Metrix force field for those planets. Tails compliments Chris as a better inventor than him, saying he couldn't have come up with this device overnight. And they decide to go to Planet Breezy after that creator's pet moment. Oh, the plane warps away. So that would be a new device. Which somehow Chris thought up because Mary Sue powers instead of Tails. Wouldn't they warp to time as well as space? That's the logic for why Chris traveled back in time when he went to Mobius and became a kid again, right? But somehow, this wormhole is different. Eggman's airship gets surrounded by an eggshell and vanishes, I guess to go super fast after the heroes. And Amy says the whole planet's in a terrible snowstorm. How is the whole planet like that? Cosmo wonders if it's because the planet egg was taken away. And she says everything there looks too cold and lonely. And they get threatened by a Metrix with a spike bolt for a tail, which looks like a dinosaur. And it gets shot by missiles from the plane, but the plane gets damaged by missiles. It would be too dark of Eggman to have made these Metrix as his robots and be sending them after planet eggs. I feel like that's the only point to these Metrix not being just robots of Eggman's to start with by this point. They can have their own personal motive that Eggman wouldn't have. But I hate that motive anyways, it's too depressing and confusing. Rouge spies on Eggman's talk, and Bakun is scared enough of her to tell her not to think he's unhappy to see her. She threatens him with his locket to get him to do a favor for her. I love that Chris at least has a new outfit, a winter coat, though I really wish the other characters bothered to have winter coats. This just raises more questions. He says he has snowshoes, and I'm expected to believe Cosmo can hear life force. And she angsts about the trees dying, and thinks there won't be a spring. Sonic insists that the Metrix won't still be around if the planet egg's already gone, and Knuckles is arbitrarily a dick, insisting that they don't have time to look for the planet egg and rescue the planet. He's not a real hero at that point, then. This is so bafflingly out of character, making an excuse to let a planet die. A real hero would want to save those planets just as much as they want to find all the Chaos Emeralds. Bokun complains that Rouge used hot chocolate with sleeping powder to knock out Eggman as robot sidekicks. Or at least she forced Bokun to make that happen. How are the robots affected by sleeping powder? And Rouge wonders if she'll go snowblind flying towards the ice castle. Sonic gets given a ring so he can magically fly in the air to go beat some robots, and Knuckles and the plane's missiles fight too. A tidal wave happens and the plane lands, and Tails says he'll have to repair it again. They predictably find an ice castle we saw earlier. I feel like the ice palace is just a cliche, because I already saw one in Satyam and Fleetway. Out of nowhere, Chris gives Sonic a Sonic Riders style airboard before Sonic Riders. Knuckles lampshades that he gets no respect at all, so I wonder why Tails hasn't made this hoverboard instead of Chris. Chris flies the plane, and Sonic goes through a loop on the hoverboard and spin dashes through some robots. Knuckles spins around a robot and throws it into the ice balls, and Cosmo is a downer as usual by asking how they'll ever defeat the robots when there's so many of them. She's like as genre blind as Sally is, always thinking that they're just gonna lose. I like that Rouge told the Metrix to get lost. Sonic moves his hoverboard so that its sharp tip will defeat the robots, and Tails' plane fires the missiles, so Sonic's hoverboard lands inside the ice palace where the emerald is trapped in a pillar of ice. Knuckles punches a hole through the wall to reunite with Sonic, and Rouge shows up. Well, once again, Knuckles and Shovel Claws come out of nowhere so we can try to dig with them. The ice pillar is harder than diamond, so Knuckles isn't allowed to be useful and get it for them. And the emerald starts shining, and the Metrix bad guy shows up with the emerald in his chest. How does this work? I guess he's a hologram, or more like he warped to behind an ice wall, and the ice walls are actually just thin walls, and not an actual thick pillar he'd be telefragged into and unable to do anything in. Rouge flies away, and the heroes run out of the ice palace, which got destroyed, and Cosmo and Chris need Sonic and Knuckles to save them from falling through the crack in the ice. Tails is playing in a tense scene, gets completely frozen when he's trying to be useful, and Amy says their cannon was frozen solid. This is pretty tense. Chris says the rockets didn't faze him, and Sonic has thrown a ring. He spin dashes at the robot, and he easily spin dashes through the summoned icicle. I'm glad there was a subversion and he didn't instantly win at this point. Cosmo apologizes for accidentally hitting the laser beam, which saves Sonic by slicing through the ice. She should have been written to do this on purpose to be useful instead. And Tails wants Knuckles to power up the laser cannon so they'll be good to go. They waste their time with padding, and the Metric says their weapon is of no use against them, and he laughs, keeping up the tension until finally the laser does destroy him. It's good that they keep up the tension over whether he'll survive until the very end. I like the music that's playing when they see all the ice melting. Rouge steals the Chaos Emerald, and Knuckles amuses me by lampshading what a Captain Obvious aim he was. Sonic then alerts their attention to the fact that grass is growing, so spring will come after all. I'm impressed that they actually let Rouge get away with a jewel for once. This better last the rest of the story arc. Bokun says that it wasn't him who put sleeping powder in the cocoa. There's no way he'd actually say that. Humanizing her for once, Rouge takes a bubble bath, and I'm expected to believe she'd do so with her gloves on, because Sega has a glove fetish for some reason, and insists on way too many Sonic characters having them. I hate metal logic. Speaking of that, bullshit! Rouge's emerald is revealed to be a fake! Why was it a fake? How? When you have the writers do so much to spite a character over and over again, it just looks like they're biased against her after a while, because she's way too unlucky to be believable. Because the writer sees every possible opportunity to humiliate her. It wouldn't be making me suspicious if the writer shows some restraint every now and then, and had her get away with every other jewel theft. Like I'd expect of a jewel thief that can fly. Like I'd expect of Rouge the Bat. Instead, she somehow fails literally every single time, and I can't buy that. That's statistically impossible. That's like the universe is out to get her. It makes it feel contrived when her bad luck is that ridiculously common and predictable, even if it makes logical sense when taken on its own. It's just the sheer amount of times that's happened. Most of the time, it just looks bad on top of everything else. But with this fake emerald shit, this really was illogical. She doesn't work as a humiliated comedy character. She's supposed to be that comedy relief character at the expense of the characters other than her, while she herself is competent. And that's why she was teasing the characters in Sonic Adventure 2. So I really don't understand why anyone would think she's competent in the show. Oh, just because she taunts Bokun with the locket at one point. That's not enough. Tails says the fake emerald was a decoy by the Metrics to make the heroes get thrown off the track. Fuck this! What the hell were they thinking? Why can't they just let Rouge keep even one Chaos Emerald? They could have the heroes get it back from her later. This was horrible writing. I can't help but feel like even most fanfictions would write Rouge better. Because I've never seen Rouge get so much bad luck before I watched the show. That fake emerald thing came out of nowhere. How could they make a fake Chaos Emerald that gets picked up as a real one? This is much stupider than when Tails made it, because we at least knew that he had experience with how Chaos Emeralds work. This is how you do this concept really wrong. This makes the fake emerald in SE2 look good, because at least that was a defining moment of what a genius Tails really is. But X-Tails couldn't have made this emerald logically, because he's so useless that the only thing he'd engineer is plane-related stuff. So how could he ever make a fake emerald? He made one in the SE2 adaptation anyways. I just remembered that because of how useless he usually is. And that's forced meta logic for you. Suddenly the hero is competent as he should be now, and only now, just so they can be like the game. And that competence is completely ignored afterwards, instead of the writer learning his lesson from the game. I could understand the fake emerald thing if it was established that Tails made a fake beforehand and Rouge took that fake. Because at least it'd make Tails look smart. But even then, I'd rather her borrow a real emerald. Especially since the Metrics would never predict that it was with her. So it'd be safer with her than with the heroes. I was suspicious when Rouge stole an emerald successfully. And you shouldn't have writing so predictably stale and formulaic that your jaded cynical audience is always right about their predictions that the show will disappoint them. This is why franchises need to take risks and shake up the formula for more than just one episode. Because when they never do that, then the audience is never gonna buy it when they pretend they are shaking things up for a second. Just like when Deku and Boku left Eggman. I was suspicious there would be a catch, and I shouldn't have been proven right. That just makes it so that the audience is smarter than the writers are every single time, and that's why predictable writing sucks. It was totally unintuitive that the Emerald was a fake. That was overly convoluted compared to just keeping things simple and having it be a real one. So that specifically wasn't predictable. But it was predictable that she wouldn't get to have a real victory. If the writing's gonna be so predictable, it should be that way because it's intuitive, because it makes logical sense in-universe. That's just good writing, and the audience being familiar with how good writing works. It shouldn't be predictable that the writing's gonna be illogical in a specific way because we're familiar with the meta logic the show runs on. Really, they shouldn't have even written this. It just didn't make any sense. All that really happened in this episode was that the hero saved a planet that was all cold and icy because Metrix had stolen its power. The last planet wasn't like that, so that feels inconsistent. I loved how tense and exciting the fight with it was. It was interesting seeing how the heroes got to that fight, where Sonic had a hoverboard, and even went through a loop-de-loop in the process. They did the tension well, but that was a terrible ending though. Ended the entire episode on a sour note. Which is a shame because it was pretty cool up to this point. It's just that Cosmo annoyed me with her genre blind whining and lack of faith in the heroes, which I already got more than enough of from Sally. At that point, she's not contributing anything positive. I can't wait for her to get to what she does contribute to make things nice that everyone talks about. And that just makes it obvious that they should have gotten to that point with her a lot sooner. I hope it was because the writers didn't get the idea to do that idea with Cosmo and Tails until that point. Because they really should have done that from the start, so Cosmo would be more than just a character who whines and does nothing. For the majority of the arc.